families.
Yes, okay, thank you. Thank you for inviting me to speak and joining the talk. So all the results I will mention are joint work with Sergey Norek. So I will start with introducing the notions and the previous results and the background to our results. So let F be a graph family closed under isomorphisms. We say that F is monotone if it's closed under taking subgraphs additionally. So for example, bipartite graph, forest planar graphs, or graphs we can, or the family of graphs we can get by forbidding some graph H as a subgraph. We say that F is hereditary if it's closed under isomorphisms and also closed under taking induced subgraph. For example, perfect graphs, or say a family of graphs which do not contain some graph H as an induced subgraph. I'm going to focus, as you could also guess from the title, mainly on the hereditary case, hereditary families of graphs. Just a quick notation, by F to N, I will denote all the graphs in the family on the vertex set 1 to N. All my graphs, all the vertex sets of all my graphs are labeled. So as I said that I will focus mainly on hereditary families of graphs, let me mention one classic old result regarding the monotone families of graphs, just to help me represent some of the definitions I will need. So you probably know, most of you know the following result, that if I consider the family of graphs which do not contain some graph H, the subgraph, then we can know the size of this family. So this is the number of graphs on n vertices in this family. And how, how do we get the lower bound? The lower bound is easy in this theorem. So why? So let me just use an example. Let's say I have the graph C7, the cycle with 7 vertices. The chromatic number is 3. So I can take some graph or some two independent sets of vertices of size n over 2 or other, doesn't really crucial. But if I take two independent sets and some choice of edges between them, I for sure will get a graph in this family without a copy of C7. And it's true in general. So if I take some graph H, I take some partition into chi of H minus 1 parts, independent parts with some choices of edges in between, this graph won't contain H as a subgraph. Okay, so let's go now to the hereditary case, and specifically in the case where I have the graph H and I'm considering the family of graphs which do not contain H as a new subgraph, which will I denote as 4 of H, or sometimes refer to them as H-free graphs. So how can I construct an H-free graph? So again, if I consider the example of C7, I can still take some partition into two independent sets, some two independent sets of vertices with any choices of edges in between, and I will get a graph which does not contain C7 as a new subgraph. But we can do better, okay? We can do better. We can actually get more graphs if we do the following. We take three sets of vertices when one of them is independent, the other two are cliques, and any choice of edges in between, and again, we will get a graph which doesn't contain C7 as an induced subgraph. So there is somewhat different behavior in the induced case, and actually, we can also take three sets of vertices where the graph induced on each one of the sets is a clique with some choice of edges. And again, we will get a C7 graph which doesn't contain C7 free graph. So why 3 is the right number versus the chromatic number that we had before. Okay, so there is a notion of the coloring number. So sorry for the similarity names, but this is how it appears in the literature. The coloring number, chi c of h, is a maximal integer L, such that we can, such that we cannot partition h into s independent set and L minus s cliques. So for example, in the case of C7, this number is 3. So maybe I didn't really convince you, but we cannot partition C, okay, this actually will be easy to convince you. We cannot partition C7 into 3 cliques because any clique in a cycle is of size at most 2. So with 3 cliques, we will cover at most 6 vertices. So C7 cannot be partitioned into 3 cliques. The other case requires a bit more case analysis, but the maximum number, such that there is some choice of number S, such that we cannot partition S into S independent set, into S independent set and L minus one, L minus S cliques, is a coloring number of H. And actually, this is the right value. And if we look on this previous result of Verdesh Frankel orders that I mentioned, in the now with respect to hereditary families defined by for being some graph is a new subgraph, this value, sorry, there is a shift by one, but this value essentially is the right value. So the coloring number plays the same role in the theory, in this extremal theory of hereditary families. It plays the same role as the chromatic number in the theory of monotone families. So the size, the extremal, the size of the extremal graph, and so on. We can define this notion of coloring number also with respect to general hereditary families, not only hereditary families that I get by forbidding some graph. So for this I need the notation. So HST will be the family of all graphs, which can be partitioned into S independent set and T cliques. And the coloring number of hereditary family F, so now I'm talking about the coloring number of hereditary family, is the maximum integer L, such that the family of all the graphs which can be partitioned into S independent set and L minus S cliques is contained in this family. And yes, it's similar to the coloring number of H, and actually using those definitions, it's not hard to observe that the coloring number of H is equal to the coloring number of 4 of H. So in the literature, maybe I will mention, besides referring to this value as a coloring number, some in the works of Promenov Steger, it's denoted as tau of H. In some other works, it's sometimes called the witnessing partition number or the binary chromatic number. Those are all the same names. They're all names for the same notion. Okay. If you have questions, by the way, you can stop me and ask, or if I go too fast, or if you want to stop me for any reason, it's okay. Okay. So you don't need to really go into the details of this theorem. Let me just mention like the interesting parts from this theorem, which is based on a sequence of works, different authors. So this result essentially says that if you consider the size, again, I'm back to the size of hereditary family, there are just a few cases for the size of hereditary family. Okay, it just falls into a few categories. I want to mention one result from the first category, and then I will focus mainly on the last, on hereditary families which contain many graphs. Okay, So first the result from the very first category. So say I have a hetero family. The size is polynomial, which means something of the form n to the s, if and only if f is star-like. What does it mean star-like? Star-like means that all the graphs in the families are s stars, starting from some size. And what is an s star? S star is structure of this form. What does it mean of this form? So I have a very big homogeneous set. So for here, for example, I have independent set, and here I have a clique. And for the rest of the vertices S, each one of these vertices in S either sees adjacent to all of C or not adjacent to any of the vertices of C. So in general, it's whatever I wrote here is equivalent to what I just said. I want to mention it because surprisingly, or maybe not, in our result we will have a structure which will be constructed from these stars. So this is why I wanted to mention it. And maybe I will mention something else, which kind of maybe will sound unrelated now, but will have again will be useful for the following. So I can actually encode or keep the information of all of this graph by knowing a few things. I mean, I need to know what are the vertices of S. I need to know for each one of the vertices of S if it's adjacent to all of C or not. And if the graph I have, which is the graph induced on C, is if it's an independent set or a clique. Okay, I will get back to it later. Okay, so actually beyond focusing on just the case on the first category on big hereditary families, we want to study the structure or the properties of almost all graphs in such a hereditary family. Okay, and what does it mean almost all? It means that if you look on the graphs, so we say that some property P holds for almost all, almost every, if the fraction of the graphs in the family which have this property P or are in this property P goes to 1. Then we say that something is holds for almost all. Why is this notion interesting? So if you didn't see it before, maybe currently it feels a bit unusual. So firstly, if I do want to learn something about the size of the family, the size of FN, it's enough to learn something about almost all graphs. So if I will say it differently, if I can derive properties of almost all graphs and then count them easily, I will essentially get the number of the graphs in FN, because again, I counted almost all. So it helped me for counting. Beyond that, there are still many interesting questions that it's interesting to look on the regular questions regarding hereditary properties in this setting. So for example, maybe you're familiar, maybe not, but the Erdős-Hajnal conjecture was studied in this setting again. In the Erdős-Hajnal, we are looking on some hereditary family, and then we want to argue about the size of the largest homogeneous set in each graph in this family. This is clearly a hard conjecture with little progress over the years, but it's actually true in this almost all setting. So what does it mean in almost all? So if I fix some graph H and then I consider the family of graphs, the H-free graphs, then in almost all I will find a homogeneous set of size n to the 1 minus epsilon, and even stronger than that, there is a result due to Kahn, Greet, McDermott, and Scott that says that actually almost all graphs, almost all H, have the property that almost all H-free graph have linear sized homogeneous. But I won't get more into that unless you will have questions due to the time restrictions. So I will move on. So there is a result regarding, so again, I'm for the, in the large range of graphs of the sizes for hereditary families. I want to mention one result. This result that I'm going to mention in the next slide is actually the starting point in R arguments, which again, I'm not sure I will be able to get into much, but let me mention this result in any case. So a UK is a bigraph that looks something like that. So I will explain. I have one set B of size K, in this example of size 2, another set A of size 2 to the K, and which point, which vertex in A stands for a subset of B. So for example, this, the top vertex stands for the subset that contains both vertices, the bottom for the empty set, etc. And I don't really care about the graph on A and B. And And the result by Alan Balogh, Bolobash, and Morris says that I first show the picture that actually, if you consider a hereditary family with a coloring number L, almost all graphs admit the following structure into L parts, in this case, T parts, such that we don't have a UK on any of those parts, and we have some small exceptional sets. Okay, small of size n to the 1 minus epsilon. So this is what is written in A and B, what they explained in the picture, but further on, it's possible to derive better bound on the size of hereditary family in this fourth category, in this fourth range. Okay, so instead of the previous result that I mentioned that showed here an additive argument of O to the n squared, actually there is an epsilon. There is some epsilon such that the additive argument here is O to the n, O of n to the 2 minus epsilon. A few more definitions, I'm sorry, but I will try to make them as easy as possible. And then I will present the results, some of the results. So we say that some graph J is F dangerous. So F, if I don't mention it, F is some, now F is some hereditary property, hereditary family of graphs. So we say that J is F dangerous if for every S between 0 and L minus 1, and again, if I don't mention L is a coloring number of F, there is some graph G which can be partitioned into some subgraph, induced subgraph of J as independent set and L minus 1 minus S clicks, and G is not an F. So let me just show an example. Maybe this will be the easiest way to digest this notion. So for example, P3 is 4C7 dangerous. Why? Why is it dangerous? Because if you remember, the L in this case is 3. So I'm looking at the rest of the graph. I still have a maneuvering of 2, and I can always partition the rest, the P4 here, into S clicks and T, S independent sets and T clicks, which sum up to 2. So I get that actually P3 is dangerous. Okay. So I can always partition P4, I can get 2 independent sets, I can get independent set and a click, and I can get 2 clicks. each one of them are combined, possible to combine with P3 and get a C7. So P3 is 4 C7 dangerous. And it says that grab J is F reduce if it's not F dangerous. And now the first structural result that I want to show is regarding hereditary families which are S critical. What are the families which are S critical? S critical, there are families such that every large enough F reduced graph, which is, as I just defined, not F dangerous, is an S star, the structure that I mentioned before. Actually, the zero critical and one critical graphs were studied before, not using the definitions that I just presented, but using a different language. So one critical families were studied by Balog and Butterfield, and one critical families were actually studied by in the work of Promo and Steger. And those families are different. So we can show that actually there are graphs which are one critical. There are families of graphs which are one critical, but not zero critical. Notice that what are the zero critical families? Zero critical families are the families where every F reduced graph is a zero star, and a zero star is always a clique or an independent set. So, let me try. Okay, so if you remember the previous drawing, I had the C, set C, and the set S. So if I'm considering zero stars, then the set S is of size zero, which means that I have only C, which means that I have only a homogeneous set, which is a clique or independent set. So I get exactly the families which were studied in the work of Balog and Butterfield. Okay. One last definition. So this one will be a bit long, but if you don't want to internalize another definition, just let's look on this picture. Okay. So I want the result that I want to show that actually S critical graphs are graphs which almost all graphs in an S critical family can be partitioned into parts, such that the graph which is induced on each one of the parts is an S star. So from stars, we go to constellations. Okay, so, yes. So now I want to define the work with this creature. So as I said, again, the result that I want to show is that actually, if you consider the S critical, almost all graphs in the S critical families, they will have this type of structure. And now let me run through the definition, but the definition will try to get this idea that I was trying to describe with this picture in words just now. So a constellation is a quadruple. What kind of information I want in the quadruple? I want to know. So J will be this color, these centers, those sets S in which one of those parts. So I want to know from each one of the vertices in J if they are adjacent to all of C. To the homogeneous set. I want to know what kind of homogeneous set I have. Here, is it a clique or independent set? And, well, I will have some graph J in the background, which I didn't really said what it is, but I will clarify in the next slide. So again, in case if it was confusing, I have in the constellation, I have some graph J. I have some functions A and B, which tells me about the vertices of J if they need to be adjacent to all of the homogeneous set or not, or to none of the vertices of the homogeneous set. And what do I have on the, what kind of homogeneous set I have? Plus, I want each one of those bits to be an S star, which means that the number of bits, the number of vertices of J that I map in each one of those pieces is at most S. So this is just kind of a template. This is just something that carries the information and you don't have to read it, I will explain. I just want to say what does it mean that some graph G admits, has this template, admits this constellation. It means that it has some partitions. So again, I'm just repeating in a way what I said in the previous slide. So again, I have this constellation in the background, this LS constellation, and I want to say that G admits this constellation. So when G admits this constellation, if I have some graph J, the bits of it I send into the parts of G, this is my G. So this blue bit goes here, this red bit goes here. So I use the function find psi to do that. You don't need to really internalize how do they look, I decide which bit goes to which part. The function, again, the function alpha says which vertices are adjacent to all of the homogeneous set and which are not to no vertex of the homogeneous set. And beta I use to decide if these sort of sets are cliques or independent. Okay. So what do we want to take from here? So I have some constellation in the background and I have the graphs which admit this constellation. Maybe this is enough actually. You don't need to really remember the alpha beta. Just think about the following. I have some constellation J, which carries all the important information about the structure, and graph that admits this constellation just obeys this information. And what I get at the end is just partition of the graph G into L parts, such that on each one of the parts I have an F star. This is what I want. And if I denote by P, J, the family of graphs which admits some J template, some given J template, then, as I mentioned, if you have a family F of S critical, if you have a hereditary family which is S critical with a coloring number L, then almost every graph in this family admits some LS constellation. Okay. I didn't mention what is irreducible. Irreducible, it just means that in none of the stars, in none of the parts, I can get a smaller center. Again, not crucial, just something technical, but this is what means irreducible. Okay. So one of our results is to characterize almost all graphs in this, which are as critical and they just have a partition into L parts, so that each one of the parts is a star. And beyond that, it's actually not very hard to count the number of graphs which admit some constellation, some reducible constellation. And so we get n to the number of vertices of J times h to hnl0, which I will remind you in the definition, this notion, this notation appeared in the definition of the coloring number. It's not crucial, it's just a location, but this says that this is the number of graphs which have a partition into L independent sets, or even easier than that, this number is just 2 to the 1 minus 1 over L times n squared over 2. I will try to write it. So it just didn't work before, but sorry, I had some technical problem.
Actually, let me tell you, I have a question, if you don't mind. I didn't quite follow how the graph J relates to the constellation. And my understanding is that you're partitioning into parts which are each stars, and the vertices of J go to these sets which are of size S within each star. I didn't see like why J matters as opposed to any other graph with the same number of vertices.
You're 100% right. Yes. So I get J on, I get J on those parts. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
So I needed to clarify. Yeah, I will correct my drawing, but yeah, I get J on those parts. Exactly.
Great, thank you.
Yeah, so let me just try that this number is 2 to the power of 1 minus 1 over L n squared. Just a number of graphs which have a partition into L independent sets. I mean, it doesn't really matter. I mean, I could just write anything which sums up to L, and this will be good enough. I mean, the point is that this number is n to the vj, the number of vertices of j, plus this expression. Okay. So how those results are usually this type of results of almost all graphs have some structure. How those results are usually shown, derived. So a very, very general framework. So we start from some hereditary family. We define some property, some bad property. As a two example, let's say that almost like I define the property B, be all the graphs in F, which so each degree of each vertex in this graph is at least n over 2. Just some two examples. So I define such a property, and then we show that the number of graphs in this property is little o of the number of graphs in the family. And then we continue, we can get rid of this set B because we already know that it's tiny. So we just throw it away and continue with the rest. And in the process, we learn something about almost all graphs in F. So we know that it cannot be the case that all the vertices in almost all graphs have degree at least n over n minus 2. Just because we define, counted, threw it away, continued with the rest. We did something similar, but we used a different language. So we use Kolmogorov's complexity in attempt to simplify the argument and make it easier to go, because usually this machinery is quite complicated. It requires a lot of steps. Sometimes you define, I don't know, 10, 15 families. And just to try to simplify and unify the known techniques, we use this language. So I briefly say what it is exactly. So let's say I have some alphabet, which contains 0, 1, and comma. It's for technical reasons, the comma, but we do need for it to contain 0, 1. Let A star to be all the strings that we can write by using the characters of A. Let U be universal Turing machine that accepts strings from A star. And Turing machine is just some mathematical model for a computational machine that is, I won't go into more details. Something that can compute given stream given an input can return an output. And the Kolmogorov complexity of a string, which we denote as C of X, is the length of the shortest binary string, such that once we feed this string, this binary string into U, into the universal Turing machine, we get back X. This is Kolmogorov complexity. And we work with Kolmogorov complexity for graphs. So now we want to feed some binary strings into the machine and output graphs. And the length of the strings that we need to feed to get X will give us some information regarding the structure and the properties of the graph that we work with. Okay, so it's not hard to show, to argue that actually the complexity closely related to the number of graphs. What I mean, so if I want to describe the complexity of a graph in some property, it's closely related to the number of graphs in this property. So I guess the upper bound is kind of easy because I can just number of the all the graphs in the property. So if I want to bound the Kolmogorov complexity of some graph, and I know that it's parts of some property, then I can easily I can number all the graphs in this property, and this will give me some bound on the complexity. This is the upper bound, the connection between the complexity and the number of graphs. A lower bound is also true. So we use that to go through the structural arguments where we consider a family, consider a graph in this family, look at its complexity. If it's too small, we can derive that probably the family, the properties that we took this graph from is small, etc. So the general form framework is the same, the language is different. I think I wrote down here a few examples of how we use a Kolmogorov complexity, but I think I will skip them. So I will have time to show the another part, the counterexample to the Reed-Scott conjecture. So I will skip this two slides that I put to give an example of how we use it, but again, those are just the very first steps in the arguments, and there are much more arguments to get to actually derive the structural results that we need. So, sorry, I'm skipping that. So just was bounding the Kolmogorov complexity of some graph in some property. Okay, so here. Okay, back to the typical structure of graphs in some hereditary family, which is defined by forbidding some graph H as an induced subgraph, and I want to use an example now of C5. And now the next thing I want to do is to present the Reed-Scott conjecture that I mentioned in the abstract, and tell as much as I can about the counterexample to this conjecture. So first I want to describe the conjecture itself if you're not familiar with it. But okay. So the conjecture is concerning graphs in form H, for some graph H, for any graph H. So again, I want to start from an example, and my example is C5, a cycle with five vertices. So as we already saw, as we already did this exercise, if we take two independent sets with any choices between, we get a graph which does not contain an induced copy of C5. The same is true if I take two clicks. And by the way, I'm working with two because the coloring number of C5. So the coloring number of C5 is two. So I don't bother to look at any other partitions. I just work with partition into two sets. The two independent sets with any choice works, two clicks with any choice works. But this is not the only way. It's not the only way to get graphs, to get for sure graphs which do not contain C5s and the induced subgraph. There is more. So not just independent, but we can also, or click. We can also consider the following case where we have a click and some graph, which is essentially, which is each joint union of clicks. So I can start from this partition and those graphs induced on the parts, again, take any choice of edges in between, and again, I will get a graph which is C5 free. Why? This is the case, sorry, it's a bit hard to see. This is the case because I can run through all the partitions of C5. I drew them here below and check that, like, say I try to find the copy of C5. How would I do it? I will put one part of C5 in one of the parts, the other part in the other part, and choose some edges in between, and maybe then I will get a C5. But the choice of clicks and the union of clicks from this choice and considering all the partitions, I actually get that there is no way to put one part, say H2, in this, any of this H2 in the click and any of the H1 in the disjoint union of clicks. So if I say put here an H, if I consider this middle case, put here an H, I cannot fit P5 in here. And this is of course on purpose because again, I want to get some partition in which I cannot get a copy of C5 with any choice in between, with any choice of edges in between. Okay. So let's again formalize it, let's say it a bit more formally. So I will say it here and then I will say it again in the next slide, but the meaning, the idea, again, you don't have to really internalize the definition. The idea is exactly in what I described here with those pieces just now in words. So let me say it like that. So let's say F1 is disjoint union of click. Clicks, the family, F1 is the family of all disjoint union of clicks. F2 is the family of all clicks. So I'm looking here, I have a pair which kind of, again, describes this behavior, this structure. F1, again, the family of all disjoint union of clicks. F2, the family of all clicks. And I say that the graph G is in this P of those two families. If we can partition it into two parts, such that the graph induced on the first part is here and the graph induced on the second part is here. The graph induced on the first part is union of clicks. The graph induced on the second part is a click. And I know for sure because of the families I chose that if G is in such a pair and such a PF1, F2, then G will be H3, C5 free. So Reed-Scott conjecture says that actually we can find for every graph H, almost all H3 graph fit in some P of F1 up to FL, with some properly chosen F1 to FL. So what are the properly chosen? Properly chosen that I must forbid some induced graph of H to get each one of those FIs. This is informal description. More formally, let me denote whatever the families F1, F2 I had before, they are here. So I want the sequence of families such that none of them is empty. Up to for every n. And in every fi, there is some graph which is forbidden, some graph which does not appear as a new subgraph of the graphs in this family. And I want it to be a subgraph of H. Then we refer to F as clean H-free pattern. And if G is in this P of F that I used before, this is the same meaning, the same idea. If it's indeed in this family of graphs, then we say that G has a clean H-free profile. And the conjecture state formally, and but the same idea as before, that for every graph H, almost all H-free graphs have, almost every H-free graph has a clean H-free profile, which means it again fits in some family of the form PF, where the parts, the pieces are taken from some families, which forbid some graph, some subgraph of H is induced subgraph. And I mean, the conjecture may make sense because there is a lot of evidence. There was a lot of evidence that this should be true. For example, it's true for cliques. It's true for cycles. So it was shown separately for even and odd cycles. And it's true for trees. So there was a lot of evidence that this conjecture should be true, but it's not. So I will try to not spend too much more time on describing, but the only thing that I wanted, I will try again to give as many ideas as I can in the time that remains, but I just want to describe the properties that we want that we have in the counterexample to the Reed-Scott conjecture. So what kind of properties? So this is just an intermediate step. I don't think that when I will finish describing the properties, you will yet be convinced that such a graphs exist. So to show that they actually exist, there is more work that needs to be done, but this is kind of the first step, what we want, what we need, what we have, for the example to the Reed-Scott conjecture, the counterexample. Okay, so our the counterexample, we will call them the L anti-Reed-Scott graph or ARS graph. And again, they have the following properties. First of all, for every S between 1 and L, VH can be partitioned into S independent sets and L minus S cliques. Note that this is not yet enough to deduce something about the coloring number because S starts from 1 and not from 0. But we have another property of those graphs, and this is that for every graph in this family, which I will explain in a second, but for every graph in this family, VH can be partitioned into a graph in this family and L minus 1 cliques. What are the graphs in these families? So firstly, it can be a vertex and disjoint union with a clique. So this is the first case, a vertex and disjoint union of a clique. So which VH has a partition into a vertex and disjoint union of a clique and L minus 1 cliques. Or an independent set of size 3 joined with a clique and L minus 1 cliques, or, and I'm now in this case, a cycle C4 joined with a clique, join, I have all the edges and L minus 1 cliques. And finally, the complement of P3 joined with a clique and L minus 1 cliques. So the H has all those partitions, and of course some choice of edges in between, which I don't really draw or really mention because I just care about the partitions that I describe for now. It also has a partition into L minus 2 cliques plus 2 graphs which have exactly 1 on H. and this non-edge, those two non-edges induce an independent set in H, so no edges in between. And finally, one last property is that these graphs have a for every partition of those graphs, which is different from the partition in the previous slide into L parts, there is some part which contains at least two non-edges. Okay, so I'll summarize. So what do we want? We want a graph H which has all those partitions. If we can somehow construct this graph H, we are golden. I mean, I didn't convince you yet, but this is what I will try to do in the in the next minutes and the next slides. But if we can find graph H with all those partitions, with all those 8, 7 partitions, more with all those properties, then we get a counterexample. Why? Okay. First of all, it's not hard to see that the coloring number of this family is L. Why? So but the first two properties, so the first property said that we have the partition to dependent sets and cliques. From the second property, we get also the partition into L plus one cliques, from which we can deduce that the coloring number is at most, well, strictly smaller than N plus one. Why? Because again, for the graph, for H, for every choice of S clique and T, S independent and T cliques, which sum to L plus one, we have the partition into this S independent and T cliques from the first two properties. From the last two properties, we cannot partition, we can deduce. It's not hard, really. I mean, maybe it's a bit confusing now because there wasn't a chance really to internalize those properties, but if you just think about it, it's not hard to see that from the last two properties, we cannot partition H into L cliques, which shows that the coloring number is at least L. So in total, we get that the coloring number is L, as we wanted. So we have that. Another thing that we had also not hard to show, really, that if we consider, if we look on this family of four H and we consider the F reduced graphs, then each one of them contains at most one on edge, which also implies that the structure, that this family F is too critical. Okay, so again, too critical means that all the F reduced graphs are stars, are two stars. And indeed, if you have at most one non-edge, so how those graphs look? So I have just one non-edge and the rest is a clique. So it's indeed a two star. So if every F reduced graph is two stars, then F is what we refer to as two critical graph, two critical family, sorry. And then we can use the results that I mentioned. The result about the typical structure in F and the counting. And the counting, I mean, the size of the graph that meet, that are in this family that need some constellation, all the two results I mentioned before. I will skip this proof. It's not hard, really. And maybe just the last bit, just the counting. So what do I mean by the counting? So to complete, to convince those properties are indeed give us a counterexample to Reed's code, we need to say that indeed that almost all H-free graphs do not have a clean H-free profile, because the conjecture said that almost all H-free graphs should have a clean H profile. So let's convince ourselves that almost all do not have a clean H-free profile. Why is it true? So to have a clean H3 profile, we need each one of the families to be F reduced, form H reduced. And in particular, each one of the parts, using the previous results, each one of the graphs on each one of the parts contains at most one non-H. And actually, if you consider an H3 profile, then it must be, maybe at this point, due to time running out, just believe me, that if you consider indeed the clean H3 profile using the previous claim, it must be the case that one of the parts contains only graphs with at most one on H and the rest are cliques. Okay, so if you consider the structure, the graphs which admit that have a H3 profile, then they have a partition into one part which contains, I will draw it a bit fast, one part which contains one on H and the rest are cliques. This is what we get using those properties, what we get in the H clean profile. So again, one part contains at most one on H, the rest are cliques. And those, and it's easy to count those graphs, their number. So we can bound the number by this expression. Why? Because we allow all the edges in between the parts, their number is at most this expression. Plus, in one of the parts, we have n squared choices for to choosing those two edges, which, sorry, to choosing those two vertices, which give us this non-edge. So we can bound the number of graphs which have an H3 profile, clean H3 profile. Just straightforward counting. In one part, we have two choices for the two vertices which induce the non-edge and all the possible choices between the parts. On the other hand, one can argue that actually there is some L2 constellation, the graph G of size 2L, which is contained in 4BNH, and then I use the lower bound plus something else that I'm not explicitly saying, but I'm using the lower bound that we have from our results on the number of graphs which admit some constellation. And because we have this containment, we get this lower bound of 4NH, and this is larger than the number of graphs in which have a clean H3 profile. So let me maybe summarize kind of the main idea of this counting, why the conjecture fails, why this construction wins in a way. It's the case because if you consider again H3 profiles, then as I said, only one part contains a non-edge and the rest are cliques. So the choices for that and the choices across are not enough when we compare it to the case where we have the partition, when we have the graphs which can be partitioned into L parts, each of the parts contains some non-edge. And we restrict the edges between those two non-edges, their number is larger than this case. So again, allowing one non-edge in one part and all the edges across give us less graphs than forbidding non-edges in each one of the parts, but fixing the edges between those non-edges, here we get more graphs versus this case, and this why this it is a counterexample and provides a conjecture. As it is, does not hold. Okay. And yes, I won't define anything else and say anything else, and I will stop here.
Thank you. Are there any questions? How much of this theory extends to hypergraphs?
I don't think I saw any results that consider hypergraphs in this almost all settings. I don't know. I'm not familiar with that. I don't think it was studied much. Actually, when I think about, maybe there is one paper by Peter Kielish, but I'm not sure if they considered hypergraphs or just some other hereditary family of graphs. Maybe I would check that, but besides that, nothing comes to mind, no.
Okay. Are there any other questions?
Yeah, I've got a question. So I guess you said that zero critical and one critical hereditary families have been studied before, and that you guys constructed two critical families. I guess I'm wondering about beyond that, right? Like, your theorem is for S critical, and so do they exist?
Yeah, it extends for any S. So we can characterize all the S critical families. So
I guess my question is, do they exist? Like, it's not clear to me.
Yeah. So, I mean, we can also brute force, just say that I consider, fix some S star on each one of the parts, choose all the possible edges. It's going to be a hereditary family, and they'll give me this structure.
Thank you. Gotcha.
Are there any other questions? Okay, if not, then thank you again, Yelena.